Testing.
Good evening.
The doors of St. Alfred Parish are open wide to welcome each and every one, with a special acknowledgement to all who are visiting our parish community. During this prayerful time together, may we encounter Jesus and experience the joy of his presence. All Souls Day envelopes were attached to the bulletin last week. Please print your names clearly on your All Souls envelopes. The parish will pray for your deceased loved ones at all the masses in November. If the names are ineligible, your loved one will still be remembered at Mass. However, their names will not appear in the Book of Remembrance. The CWL executives are reaching out to the parish members attending the event on October 17th to bring a small tray of sweets prepared and covered to the hall before Mass. We will be serving refreshments and coffee that evening. Thank you in advance for your kindness. Adoration and confessions will be canceled on Monday, October 9th, due to the public holiday. Thanksgiving Day, Monday, October 9th, Mass will be celebrated at 9 a.m., and the parish office will be closed. Today is the 27th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Judeo-Christian history and today's readings remind us again that being called to be God's people is a gift and a privilege. But it is also a responsibility that comes with expectations. Even in difficult times, we hear that what is offered to us is not to be squandered. We are free, of course, to respond however we choose. But if we accept our calling, it comes with a price. Being chosen, being Christian, as with all relationships, is not for the faint-hearted. Before we begin our celebration of the Mass, we would like to like everyone to warmly greet those around them. Our celebrant today is Father Hugh.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be always with you. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. The word Eucharist means to give praise and thanks to God, so it's fitting that we gather around this altar on this Thanksgiving weekend to thank God for the many, many blessings we have received individually and as a country, to prepare ourselves to celebrate worthily the sacred mysteries. Let us first of all pause and call to mind our sins. Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. Almighty ever-living God, who in the abundance of your kindness surpass the merits and the desires of those who entreat you, pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah,
judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel. The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel. You brought a vine out of Egypt. To plant it, you drove out the nation. It stretched out its branches to the sea, to the great river it stretched out its shoots. The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel. Then why you broken down its walls? It is plucked by all who pass by. It is ravaged by the boar of the forest, devoured by the beasts of the field. The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel. God of hosts, turn again, we implore. Look down from heaven and see. Visit the vine and protect it, the vine your right hand has planted. The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel. And we shall never forsake you again. Give us life that we may call upon your name. Lord of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine on us and we shall be saved. The vineyard of the Lord is the
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worth of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Chosen you from the world, says the Lord, to go and bear fruit that will last.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When their harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves, beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone'? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom." The Gospel of the Lord.
A few years ago, I gave a homily at my home parish in Dublin. Following the Mass, I had a chat with the pastor in the rectory. "You have to be relieved that that's over you now," the pastor said. "I am." And he continued, "Do you know something? If I hadn't my Sunday homily prepared by Thursday, I'd be weak. As soon as the last Sunday Mass is over, I say to myself, 'If only I had next Sunday over me now, I'd be grand.'" Now, this priest was a real worrier. His 52 weeks of the year was a succession of worry. As soon as one ordeal had been overcome, he replaced it with another. By temperament or by habit, he was never at rest. His mind was never at peace. Now, would you describe yourself as a worrier? I suppose to some extent we all are. If you mean by worry that we concern ourselves about the kids, about our aging parents, or getting sick, or losing our job, or exams, or having enough money to get by on. If we mean by worry, concerning ourselves about others or taking our responsibilities seriously, then of course we worry, and we're right to worry. But when I ask you, are you a worrier? I mean, and I think most people would mean, do you worry unduly? Do you worry too much? Do you worry in a negative, destructive way? Now, all sorts of clever things have been written about worry to remind us of the futility, the pointlessness of worry. Things like, never trouble trouble until trouble troubles you. Or, today is the tomorrow you're worried about yesterday and all is well. Or, the worried cow would have lived until now if she had saved her breath, but she feared her hay wouldn't last all day, so she mooed herself to death. Now, we nod our heads in appreciation of these things. We think they're very good. We think they're very clever. They may help us get things in perspective that little bit better, but they don't stop us worrying, especially those of us who are inclined to do so. We go on worrying in case the hay won't last, and we moo ourselves to death. Now, St. Paul has something to say to us in today's second reading. Do not worry about anything, he says, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your minds and hearts in Christ Jesus. It sounds very reassuring, but in case you're saying to yourself, it's easy for him to talk, let's understand his situation when he wrote those words. This letter to the Philippians is known as one of the captivity epistles. And it's known as captivity epistle because when Paul wrote it, he was in prison, and the chances were that he would never come out alive. His fate was uncertain, and the likelihood of his execution was very, very real. And it was when he was physically confined, immediately threatened, and perilously balanced between life and death that Paul could say, "Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." What St. Paul is telling us out of his own experience of suffering is to link worry and prayer. Don't pretend your worry is not there, but send it up to God in prayer. And the fruit of that prayer is the peace from God, which surpasses all understanding. St. Paul is saying no more to us than Jesus himself when he said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me." Or again, think of the flowers growing in the fields. They never have to work or spin, Yet I assure you that not even Solomon in all his royal robes was clothed like one of these. Now, if that is how God clothes the wildflowers growing in the fields, will he not much more look after you, you who have so little faith? What it boils down to is that we must not link worry to worry. We must try to link it with prayer and faith and trust in God. Some anonymous writer said it very, very well. My God and I will walk the plank together. My God and I will jump into the sea. My God and I will meet all kinds of weather. My God and I will walk triumphantly. Worrying is a terribly corrosive thing. It can eat away at the fiber of the mind, spoil the present, blur the future, and paralyze the will. Sharing it helps a bit with a friend, a counselor, or a confessor. It helps to confront its causes too. Indeed, it's important to confront them and, if possible, deal with them. It helps to pray. It doesn't eliminate worry entirely, but Paul is right. It helps to pray. What helps the most is to keep reminding yourself in prayer that no matter what befalls you, you can count forever on the love of God. That's one reality that worry can never corrode. So the more I trust in God, the less I worry. The more I share with him, the less I've left to worry on my own. People who are over anxious tend to think very negatively. They imagine the worst scenario, and of course, this is disastrous. We must concentrate on the good and not the bad. Now, many people devour the newspapers every day or surf the internet and social media. It's hard to read the newspapers, watch the news, or go on social media these days without coming away depressed. So full are they with bad news and lots of misinformation. Instead of filling our minds with all kinds of negativity, St. Paul says, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. The power of positive thinking is well known. However, it's not just a question of thinking nice thoughts. We must try to do these things. Thoughts alone will not suffice. We must pursue goodness in our actions. St. Paul says, keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and seen in me. In Jesus' parable of the vineyard, a lot of horrible things happen, but evil doesn't have the last say. In the end, goodness triumphs. This shows us that there is only one way to combat evil, and that is with good. Jesus didn't answer evil with more evil. He triumphed over evil by doing good. If we do what we can and put our trust in God, that St. Paul assures us that the peace of God, which is so much greater than we can understand, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Peace comes not from having an easy and tranquil life. We can have peace even in the midst of struggle and turmoil, provided we are on the side of right. Then God and the God of peace will be with us. Let me close with this prayer for worriers. Father, help me not worry when things don't go the way I expect. Jesus said, we are not to fret, not to worry, not to let our hearts be troubled or afraid. He said, we are to trust in you and also in him. May it be so in my life, no matter how impossible things seem. Keep me from worrying about tomorrow, for each day has enough troubles of its own. When such troubles come, help me to cast all my anxiety on Jesus, because he cares for them. Help me not to be anxious about anything, but to pray about everything with thanksgiving. For when I do, you'll give me a peace that surpasses my understanding, and such peace will guard my heart and my mind in Christ Jesus. And I ask this prayer through the same Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us stand and together recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead.
And life everlasting.
We pray now for our many needs and the needs of the whole world.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That we may have the courage to act on Paul's words, to give witness by lives that are true, just, gracious, and honorable. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those throughout the world who suffer for their faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who falsely portray Christianity as a source of material success, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have never felt gifted by God or anyone else, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those awaiting a good harvest, and those whose harvests are disappointing or disastrous, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are responsible for the future of our country, our environment, and our safety, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who need public assistance of any kind, and for those who have been denied assistance, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That each of us may be truly thankful this Thanksgiving Day for all the blessings that God has bestowed upon us, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick in our families and in our parish community, especially Mary and Kelly, Richard D'Souza, Jane Coco, Mel Cervantes, Michaela Gebhardt, Anna Chirozzi, Josephine Smith, Lisa Wong, Ron Harris, Brian Piplinski, Nicole Dierks, Terry Small, Paige Johnson, Patty Matheson, Francis Van Esch, Richard, Cherish Reese, Marina Suvik, Sherry Forrest, Carolyn Teitler, Ernie Russell, Donald Menzefeld, Marie Harris, Lucas Olivieri, Terry Carmichael, Joe McGahan, and Ida Riganelli. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Yvonne Labatt and Mark Ferretti, and for their families and friends who greet them with love. At this Mass, we remember Carmine Esposito, Tom Lecky, and Amerizia Squartecchia. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for calling us to be your people. Help us to be faithful in our commitment to you and to one another, and forgive us when we fail. Strengthen our sense of responsibility that comes with the gifts you have given us. And we make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your commands, and through the sacred mysteries, which we celebrate with dutiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Gerard, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, Saint Alfred, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. For those attending Mass online, the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Christ, our brother,
Let's pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed into what we consume through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace now, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Storms, chant to this place.